2005 was a very interesting year for fantasy films. Audiences were still recovering from the staggering greatness of the Lord of the Rings trilogy. Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire was released, and Peter Jackson's less loved but still gargantuan blockbuster King Kong came to theatres. This was a time in which an underappreciated film genre became suddenly crowded with quality adaptations. It's hard to imagine how there could be room for any other good fantasy cinema. Enter Andrew Adamson's The Chronicles of Narnia, The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, the first modern cinematic adaptation of C.S. Lewis's beloved children's book. A film loaded with the weighted expectations to live up to the original novel, as well as the need to be good enough to return a profit for Disney, with comparatively less hype than its competitors. 15 years later, and Narnia stands in its own light, away from the shadow cast by the epics of that time. It's a gorgeous film, which exists as an exceptional piece of filmmaking, filled with heart, and celebrates the magic that can happen when every aspect of movie making is done right. The most impressive aspect of this modern Narnia is the overall visual direction. From the CGI to the production design, the first Narnia movie is an impressive gem of visual indulgence. CGI is an art form in itself, and it's evident that the VFX team at Industrial Light and Magic had the resources and somehow the time to create characters and environments that even now haven't aged. Take a look at this scene with the beavers.
Oh, stop squirming! Ah. You're worse than Beaver on bath day.
Worst day of the year.
The lighting is startlingly accurate. The movement of the animation feels so emotive and natural, expressive without being distracting. But the true star here is Aslan, a radiant example of CGI's best capabilities, especially for 2005. Not only do his fur textures look great, but his movement and emotions suggest Aslan is beyond just a standard lion. He has the one thing that other newer films have tried and failed to recreate: expression. We are not staring into the eyes of an animal with predatory instincts. This is something more human, relatable, anthropomorphic. The emotion of Aslan's expressions say just as much, if not more, than anything voice actor Liam Neeson was ever given to read. All this hard work with CGI and animation feels effortless, to the point where the sheer brilliance of this technical artistry is the fact that the visual effects blend in so subtly with the real-world elements. There were only two or three scenes that looked dated from an effects standpoint, and all instances of those quirks were a result of green screen, which, as we are discovering, is already an outdated technology. But there is a lot more visual magic here than just VFX. Roger Ford and his team of art directors have honored the fantastical realism of C.S. Lewis's novel with imaginative set design and suggests a world that looks inhabited and lived in without offering anything distracting or sensory for the sake of eye candy. This respect extends towards the incredible effort of practical makeup by Howard Berger and Tammy Lane. The creature design looks lifelike and filled with character. This is beyond prosthetic masks, with a diverse range of detailed bodysuits and often effects designed to blend seamlessly with CGI. But what's a visually stunning world if you can't hear or feel it?
Music, oh, such music.
Harry Gregson-Williams, the film's composer, is the man behind the true magic of Narnia. His soundtrack is full of life, with recurring motifs that infuse the film with its distinct Narnian flair. The sounds and melodies so distinctly belong to this unique world that it becomes the pulsating life force of the film. The music is so diverse, from the haunting Tumnus lullaby to the epic scope of the battle. To the uplifting and joyous symphony we hear in Father Christmas. Each piece is so full of character, with unique tones that perfectly complement each scene they're married with. This is no small feat for its time either. Remember, Narnia was released into a world already in love with the iconic scores from The Lord of the Rings and Harry Potter. I guess that's why so many of the tracks Gregson created are so strong. They had to be. They needed to be special. They needed to have their own identity and elevate Narnia to the heights of spectacular fantasy. We take for granted that a film geared towards children has one of the most impactful openings to a battle sequence ever. I think this was the point of the film where I realized just how well directed the first Narnia is, especially with the way Andrew Adamson handles action. This is kind of unbelievable, but Adamson's only feature films before Narnia were Shrek and Shrek 2. If anything, this shows Adamson's ability to balance story with action, and absurdly enough, how to handle scope for important scenes. Yes, Shrek and Narnia are tonally two very different works of fantasy storytelling, but it makes sense that Narnia's action should be so involving and impactful when observing the experience Adamson would have gained from his previous works. Another important quality of Adamson's direction that carried over from the Shrek films is his knack for pacing. Both Adamson and editors Sim Evan Jones and Jim May have taken a very streamlined approach to the way scenes progress throughout the film. Essentially, no time is wasted introducing us to the characters and world, but nothing valuable is ever skipped for the sake of time. The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe stands at 2 hours and 23 minutes in length. A runtime like that is significant, where even the extra 20 minutes could have resulted in a bloated or uneven experience. Narnia excels so much with its kinetic pacing that by the time the film credits roll, you won't realize nearly 2.5 hours have passed. All these elements weave around each other to form a beautiful piece of film with a sense of adventurous spirit and heart. Narnia was a joyful surprise back in 2005 and remains a surprisingly wonderful example of great fantasy cinema today.
There you are.
What were you all doing in the wardrobe?
You wouldn't believe us if we told you, sir.
Try me.